The CBS Radio Mystery Theater presents... Come in. Welcome. I'm E.G. Marshall. What is paradise? According to Mr. Edward Fitzgerald, it's a book of verses underneath the bough, a jug of wine, a loaf of bread, and thou beside me in the wilderness. Poetry, wine, women, and song. Certainly a most happy combination, but with all due respect to the poet, are they really enough?
We have to kill him.
What are you saying?
You know what I'm saying. Don't pretend to be dull or slow or stupid. We have to kill him.
Wait. Let's consider
that... Don't try to stall for time. We have none. I know what you want. A day, a week, a month to consider the pros and cons, but it doesn't matter. We'd reach the same decision anyhow.
The same decision?
The only decision. We have to kill him.
Our mystery drama, Heroes Welcome, was written especially for the Mystery Theater by Sam Dan and stars Tony Roberts.
I'll be back shortly with Act One.
Build a little nest somewhere in the west and let the rest of the world go by. That was a popular song our grandparents used to sing, and it remains a popular sentiment to this very day. The idea of a safe and lovely little haven away from the fire and smoke of civilization. A dream come true. No?
My lord?
What? Oh, yes. Yes. What is it, Malaya?
What does my lord think about?
Oh, I don't know exactly if I'm thinking about anything.
Oh, my lord is displeased with me.
No. Nothing of the sort.
It is true. Of late, there has been a look, a faraway look in my lord's eyes, as if he is trying to see something which is not here.
Yeah. So?
And so it must be that I no longer please my lord.
No. You're fine, Malaya. You're all right. In every way.
It has been almost 6 years.
6 years.
It is a long time for a man and a woman to be married to each other.
Is it?
Oh, yes. And I am no longer young. Soon I shall be 22 years old.
None of this has anything to do with you.
Oh, please do not leave our house, my lord.
Who said anything about leaving?
You could marry my sister, Dahlia. She is beautiful. You have seen her. And she is 15. And you could also marry my cousin, Sandara. And my cousin, Risala.
No, Malaya, no. It's all right. I don't need any more wives.
But you are thinking of someone else. Who is she?
I don't know.
Was she your wife?
Yes.
And my lord does not know who she was?
When your people found me in the water, I wore this gold ring. I know among my people it's a sign that one is married. Therefore, I must have had a wife.
And therefore, you must have loved her.
Yes.
More than you love me? What was she like?
I don't know. I don't even know what I was like.
My lord is troubled.
It's all right, Malaya. It's all right.
Tawa, Aritawa.
Oh, it's you, Chief.
Yes.
I'm sorry. I was watching the waves.
A good thing to do. One acquires much wisdom.
Aritawa. After all this time, I'm still not used to the name. Aritawa. One who came from the water.
But it describes you.
I suppose so.
I would speak with you. My daughter, Malaya, tells me you are unhappy.
Oh.
You are a man who should be happy. You are tall. You are strong. You are clever. You know so many things. You are so good for my people. Why are you so sad? I know, but the other world is gone.
Why can't I remember it?
Perhaps you...
Yeah? Perhaps what?
Nothing.
No? You were going to say something.
Perhaps you do not remember the other world because you do not choose to remember it.
What are you saying?
I have seen it among the people. Sometimes a man, a woman, has done something. Or perhaps sometimes the world becomes too heavy.
Heavy?
Yes, for many reasons. Or even for no reason. The world becomes too heavy to bear. So one wishes to forget. One wishes so hard for forgetfulness that the gods say, yes, let him forget.
Doesn't matter where you are. You can even be shipwrecked on an unknown island in the South Seas. Everybody is a psychiatrist.
Be troubled no longer, my son. Look about you. You have everything a man could ever ask for. Or is that the trouble?
My lord, awake.
Huh? What?
Awake.
Wake? What for?
Look.
At what?
At the sky, my lord.
Well, what's the matter with it?
See? It glows red.
Hey. What is that?
It is Saruman.
What?
Saruman. The volcano. Oh, listen, the drums.
What's happening?
Hurry, hurry, we must go to the water's edge.
Aritawa, come. Saruman will soon speak with words of flame and burning rock. We must take to the canoes. All the people, to the canoes. This may be far enough.
Look how the fire burns.
Yes, but it is still within the mountain. Soon it will speak. And then great bursts of flame shall light up the entire sky.
What will happen to the village?
Oh, it will be destroyed.
Destroyed?
Yes. There will be nothing left.
You take it so calmly.
And why not? Everything that is of any value is out here. In the canoes. All the people. Our few pigs. Our goats. As for the rest, in a week, we can rebuild the village.
Father, listen.
It begins.
What?
Saruman is clearing his throat. In a moment, his speech will begin.
The waves are getting higher.
It is nothing. Nothing, my son. Help hold the canoe steady. Now hear him. Hear Saruman.
And the flames. See the flames.
No. No.
We are safe.
No. Not again.
Aritawa.
Not again.
My lord.
Aritawa, there is no danger.
No, no.
Father, he has fainted.
Aritawa.
He tries to speak, Father. What is he saying?
Frank. Frank. What's happening?
What is he saying, Father?
Frank.
What is it, my son? What is it?
Frank, the ship. What's happening to the ship?
My lord.
Silence, my daughter.
Frank. Frank.
He is living another life. In another world. Do not awaken him.
Frank, what happened?
I don't know, Russ. We must have hit something.
Frank, the ship. It's on fire.
Attention! Attention! There has been an accident in the engine room. Now there's no need for panic. Report to your lifeboat station.
Frank,
The ship's gonna go down.
Well, let's do what he says. Let's get to the lifeboats.
Follow the instruction of your boat crew. There's enough time to get off safely. We have already sent an SOS. Help is on the way. Now board the boats in an orderly manner.
Frank, everything is back in the stateroom.
It doesn't matter.
All the papers, all the data.
There's nothing we can do.
Or maybe there's nothing you can do.
Russ, don't be crazy.
Oh, I'm going back to get it.
You can't. The fire is in the way. Frank, we'll be ruined.
Well, at least we'll save our lives.
What good are our lives?
Boatswain, get those people on boat number four. Let's go.
Plans, the diagrams, they're gone, Frank.
We're lucky to be alive.
What are we going to do now?
Start all over again, I guess.
Say goodbye to all that work. All that blood and sweat.
Russ, everything's going to be all right.
Yeah, maybe for you, but I'm the one who broke his back getting this whole business set up.
Each of us did what he was supposed to.
Help!
Yeah.
Help!
Hey, listen.
Someone's in the water.
I see her. She's going to drown. Hold on, lady.
Russ!
Help!
Russ, wait!
Okay. Okay, okay. I've got you.
Hold on!
Hey, you'll be okay, lady. You'll be okay.
That's good. Now, try to lift her just a little bit. Fine. Grab her. Boatswain! Good. Good. Now, get the man.
Hey. Hey, where did Russ go? He's disappeared.
Russ, where are you? Russ, hold up your hand.
We have to be around this very spot. Circle it slowly. Slowly.
Russ. Russ, where are you? Where are you?
I'm here, Frank. I'm here. Here.
My lord.
I'm here.
Oh. Oh, Haritawa. You had gone into another world for a moment.
Yes. Yes. The other world.
Do you know that world?
Yes. It's my world.
My lord, no.
You know now who you are?
Yes. Now I remember. Suddenly, it was the explosion and the flames of the volcano.
Ah.
It brought back the memory of another explosion. Another fire.
My lord.
We had taken a ship from Australia to New Guinea. We had a project and the ship had some sort of accident and sunk. I was in one of the lifeboats. I tried to help someone. I was about to get back into the boat when a wave came along. I swallowed a mouthful of water and I just sank beneath the surface. When I was able to come up again, the lifeboat had moved away. I could hear them calling. I called back, but they couldn't hear me and they just sailed away.
Yes, that is why you were in the water.
I was about to drown, but a spar from the ship floated by. I managed to get a hold of it. I tied myself to it with my belt. I don't know how long I was in the water. It may have been days. And after a while, I forgot everything. Even who I was. I lost all consciousness. And then I seemed awake, and I found myself on your island.
Yes. We saw you floating in the sea.
My lord, you know now of your other world?
Yes, Malaya. I know now of my other world.
And you will go back to that other world?
Yes, Malaya. I must.
Oh, no, please, my lord, do not leave me.
But I must.
No, no.
Be silent, my daughter. Why do you wish to go back?
Why? I must.
Again, I ask, why? Think, Aritawa, before you answer. Why must you go back?
think the answer is obvious. Or is it? After all, just because he remembers who he is in that other world, does that mean he should rush to get back there? The answer, my friends, depends on what it is he would be coming back to. We will be coming back to Act Two shortly. If you were around during World War II, you may remember a very popular song that went, "A sleepy lagoon, a tropical moon, and two on an island." It was a big hit because everyone is thinking about those tropical island paradises. However, perhaps the desire may be overwhelmed by the reality. Our present-day hero has found one, and it seems he intends to give it up.
My lord is leaving.
Yes, Malaya.
Oh, please, take me with you.
I can't do that.
My lord does not wish to do it. You have a wife.
Yes.
What is her name?
Dorothea.
Oh, take me with you.
But I told you it's impossible.
Because of Dorothea?
Yes.
But why? She should welcome me. I would help her make you happy.
Now, Malaya.
If my lord brought her here, I would welcome her.
In my country, a man is permitted only one wife.
Oh, my lord is joking. Please, not now. My heart is heavy with sorrow.
It's the truth.
How long has she been your wife?
By now, it must be 15 years.
15 years? How old is this Dorothea?
Well, she's almost 40.
40? Oh, what does a woman of 40 know of love? She must be old, fat. Oh, please, my lord, do not leave me. You will never find anyone who loves you as much as I do.
Malaya, be silent.
But, father, my lord is leaving me.
He is your lord. He may do what pleases him.
But I...
Malaya.
Yes, father.
Leave us. We must talk, your husband and I.
Yes, father.
So, you are leaving.
Yes, chief.
I am sorry, Aritawa.
My name is Russ. It's Russell Thomas Anderson.
To me, you shall always be Aritawa, one who has come from the water. Have you thought about the things I spoke of?
Yes.
And still you decide to go.
I have no choice.
In my youth, I have been to your world, to a place called Australia, a place called Papiti. I have worked there for money.
I didn't know that.
Oh, yes, for money. And then I saw how the people of your world live. It was not to my liking. Now, I must help.
I don't know what you can do.
You will need a large canoe to take you across the wide open water to Luri, where the big boats come.
Thank you, Chief. I've been so busy just thinking of going home that I hadn't stopped to plan the mechanics of it.
Here is this box. You will need what is inside.
What is it? Oh, it's money.
Yes. It is all the money that our young men rush off to make. And then when they bring it home, they discover we have no use for it. We already have everything of value that it can buy.
I understand.
So take it. I know that in your world, these pieces of paper are the magical talismans that bring food and clothing and shelter. Indeed, these pieces of paper can buy anything and anyone.
Thank you, Chief. But it's so much money.
It is of no value to us here.
But it's a fortune.
You are Aritawa, the adopted son of a royal chief. It is altogether proper that you travel as a prince of the blood.
Okay, Louie, you can pack it in for the night. See you tomorrow. Wow, what do you know? A customer. What'll it be?
I'll just have a beer.
A late night beer drinker. Well, why not? You got 5 minutes to lights out. Hey, you know, you look familiar.
Do I?
Yeah, you remind me of somebody.
Who?
It'll come to me in a minute. Let me tell you why. Next week, we're going to dedicate a monument.
Really? What sort of a monument?
Oh, a couple of years ago. Oh, gee, must be close to 6 or 7. We had a guy who got drowned.
Where?
Oh, in the South Sea someplace. The guy was shipwrecked. And he jumped out of a lifeboat to save some woman. But he got lost in the water.
Oh.
Yeah, he's the closest thing to a hero this place ever had. So we're giving him a monument. Can you imagine?
I suppose so.
Yeah, they already named a street after him. Anderson Boulevard. And a new school, Russell Thomas Anderson High. Hey, yeah, that's who you remind me of, Russ.
Oh?
Yeah, Russ. Good old Russ. Oh, many's a night he'd help me close this joint. Yeah, but he's gone now, and for good. I do mean good.
You mean you're glad he's gone?
Oh, no. We were pals, yeah. But you see, he did something when he died that he couldn't do while he was alive.
What's that?
He brought an industry into the town.
What industry?
The Russell Thomas Anderson Foundation.
And what's that?
Hey, you know, you do look a lot like Russ. Kind of bigger, heavier, and you got a good sunburn. Well, anyhow, he did a terrific thing. He was a hero. And he died. It was all in the media, you know. So, everybody sent his wife money. His wife, Dorothea. You know what she did with it?
How would I know?
Well, I figure it's known all over the U.S.
I've been away.
You must have been. Well, she and his ex-partner, Frank Evans, they organized the Russell Thomas Anderson Foundation. I told you about it.
What does this foundation do?
Well, it's got this slogan... Greater love hath no man than this, that he lay down his life for his friend. Except I think old Russ went and done one better. He gave up his life for a stranger.
About the foundation.
Yeah, Dorothy and Frank, they send money and give scholarships to the kids of people who die trying to help others.
I see.
I want to tell you, that thing grew. At first, Dottie ran it out of her living room, and then she had to take an office. And now they got a whole building. Well, one way or another, counting part-timers, they must have 50 people on the payroll.
50?
Yeah, it's the biggest employer in town. They get contributions from all over the world. And how did it all begin? Just because Rush jumped out of a lifeboat to save some dame and got himself drowned. Yeah, you know what I think? He must have been drunk.
And this Dorothea, Mrs. Anderson, she... Never remarried?
Ah, she can't afford it. She has to be the brave widow. Hey. Hey.
What is it? Are you all right?
I better pour myself a shot.
You sure you're okay?
I see you still draw those figure eights on the bar with the bottom of your glass, don't you? Russ?
Yeah, Charlie. It's Russ.
You ain't a ghost?
No.
You're alive?
Yeah.
What happened, Russ?
After a while, I got fished out of the water by some natives.
Oh.
But for a long time, I didn't know who I was. I just found out. It was about a week ago.
Yeah.
I got to Hawaii, and I was going to phone Dottie, but I thought it would be too great a shock.
You can say that again.
So I thought I'd come into town quietly, you know, sort of break the news gradually.
You decided to come back home, huh?
Well, sure.
Russ... You and I, we've been pals since high school.
Of course, Charlie.
I don't know how good an idea it is.
How good an idea what is?
You're coming back here.
But, Charlie, I'm alive.
Yeah, but for a lot of people, that might not be too good an idea.
But, Dottie, can you imagine how happy she'll be to see me? Well?
It's been 6 years.
Are you trying to tell me something?
Look, Russ, you have to do what you think is best.
I've been so anxious to see her, Charlie.
So why didn't you?
The mechanics of the thing. What can I do? Just ring her bell and say, hello, here I am?
There's no other way to do it.
I guess not. I should have phoned her. I was just too... too what? Too scared. I don't know.
You either have to barge in on her or give her a ring first.
Yeah. Yeah, the shock of seeing me on the doorstep might be too much. On the phone, I can break it to her gently. That's the only way to do it.
There is another way. Leave town. Don't let her know you're alive.
Well, why should I do that? She's my wife.
You look great, Russ. I never saw you looking so terrific. You must have had a good idea wherever it is you were. Why don't you just go back there, huh?
Are you trying to tell me something, Charlie?
No.
Okay to use the phone?
Yeah, sure.
I still remember the number. It's funny how there are some numbers you never forget.
Don't she answer, Russ?
Hello?
It's some trick to play on a person at 2 a.m.
Hello?
Russ, what's the matter?
That was Frank. Frank?
Yeah, I guess it was.
Frank? What's he doing at my house at 2 a.m.? What am I asking you for? What else would he be doing at my house at 2 a.m.? How long has this been going on, Charlie?
I don't know. A couple of years.
Yeah, what's a couple of years? 2, 3, 4, 5?
Yeah, about that.
They didn't waste any time. Either of them. Did they?
Russ, you were dead.
I was alive.
But they didn't know that.
Still...
Still what, Russ?
They couldn't wait to get together, could they? I'm going over there right now.
No, don't.
What do you mean, don't?
I know you've got a temper. Now, cool down first, Russ. Please don't go now.
Home the conquering hero comes. Except it would seem that this is a conquering hero who would be more appreciated if he remained an absent hero. Come to think of it, the best liked heroes seem to be the ones who are no longer around. Somehow the flesh produces problems that the memory need never put up with. But all this must be reconciled somehow in Act 3. They say, when the cat's away, the mice will play. To this we might add that when the cat is away for good, the mice will play for keeps. Of course, nothing is as clean and as neat and as clear-cut as it is in these deft little proverbs, but they do serve as a general indication of human nature. Sometimes.
Listen to me, Russ.
It's probably been going on for a long time, hasn't it, Charlie? Even before I left home. And he's supposed to be my best friend.
These things, well, sometimes people just can't help themselves.
All the time I was away, I thought about her every minute.
Russ, let me tell you something.
There's nothing you or anybody else can tell me. I'm going to take care of this myself.
Russ, wait.
In my own way.
Russ, come back. Don't go there. Oh, boy.
Maybe I ought to call the sheriff. No, no. We don't need that kind of scandal.
Hello.
Hello, Dottie.
Whoever you are, do you know what time it is?
It's me, Charlie.
Charlie?
Hey, Charlie. Over at Charlie's Bar and Grill.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, what is it?
Well, just get a grip on yourself.
What are you talking about?
Just get braced for this, will you? Take a deep breath. He's back.
Who's back?
Who do you think?
Oh. What?
Russ!
Oh, no, no. No, it's impossible.
Why is it impossible?
Because...
Because you want it to be impossible.
He drowned.
No, he didn't.
He didn't?
Somehow he made it to an island, and the natives took care of him. He must have had amnesia. Wake up, Frank, and get...
Do you insinuate that Frank...
Come on, there's no time for games. Get out of there.
What are you saying?
I'm saying he knows about you and Frank, and he's ripping mad. You know his temper. I never seen him in a worse mood. Now get out of there. Hide someplace till he cools down.
Who knows he's back?
Just you and me. And I guess you have to tell Frank. So it's just the three of us. Get out of there. You don't have more time than 5 minutes.
Dottie, who was on the phone? Was it that same crank who rang before?
It was Charlie. You know, the bartender.
Why would he call at this hour?
Frank, sit down. Try to understand this. Russ is back.
What'd you say?
I said Russ is back.
Russ is back from the dead?
It seems he wasn't dead to begin with.
Oh, no, no. Hey, I was there. I was in that lifeboat. I saw him in the water. I saw him go under.
Now, I'll just state the facts. According to Charlie, who just spoke with him, he survived somehow. Made his way to an island. But he suffered from amnesia until recently.
But, Dottie...
Let me finish. He knows about you and me.
Oh.
He's furious. He's on his way here.
Ooh, that's no good, no good at all.
He's probably coming here to kill us both.
Yeah, that would be his initial reaction, but look, it has to take him between 5 and 10 minutes to get here from Charlie's. By that time, he'll have cooled down.
Frank, I want you to open that bureau drawer. The middle one.
Why?
Just do it.
All right.
Do it. You'll see a brown sweater on the left-hand side.
Yes?
Now lift up the sweater and you'll see what's underneath it.
It's a revolver.
Yes.
Hey, Dottie, we won't need this.
Yes, we will.
But I told you, by the time he gets here...
We'll have to kill him.
What are you saying?
Know what I'm saying. Don't pretend to be dull or stupid. We have to kill him.
Why?
You know why. Because he's alive.
Well, what does that mean?
Don't pretend to misunderstand.
Dottie!
He has to be dead. Otherwise, this whole thing, this entire enterprise we have here just crumbles away.
But even if he's alive, he's still a hero.
No, he's just another brave guy. What makes him different is the fact that he gave his life.
Well, how can we just...
You're just making objections to stall for time, Frank, but we have none. I know what you want. A month or two to weigh the pros and the cons. But what does it matter? In the end, you'd only come to the same decision. We have to kill him.
But how can we...
Good. You agree with me. We've made progress.
Hey, wait. I never said...
You no longer object in principle. You have now reduced it to what Russ would call the mechanics of the problem. Now, it's really simple. You have the revolver. You shoot him when he comes in. The house is set far enough away so that no one will hear the shot.
But later...
We'll put him in the station wagon and drive out to some desolate, deserted, woodsy area and bury him.
Look, Dottie, the police have ways of finding...
That's only if the police are looking. Russ died 6 years ago, remember? Why would anyone...
Dottie...
Frank, darling, I know this sounds callous... Cold-blooded. Brutal. Yes. But that's only because we must do it so quickly. Believe me, even if we had weeks, even months to get used to it, we would be convinced by out of logical necessity. It has to be done, Frank. The revolver's loaded.
Yes. I know.
Then let's not talk about it anymore. Let's just do it.
Wait.
Why?
Charlie, the bartender, he knows.
What does he know?
He knows Russ is back.
Does he?
Well, he called you up to tell you.
Did he?
Yes, he knows Russ is on his way over here right now.
Oh, we don't know anything about that. Our point is that Russ never arrived here. How could he? He drowned. He died a hero 6 years ago.
But Charlie will say that...
I don't think Charlie will say anything. How can he? Does he want everyone to think he's crazy? Who'd believe a story like that? Well, I think if Charlie insisted on it, he'd be put away. Besides, I don't think Charlie is so anxious for Russ to come back.
Charlie was his friend.
So were you. Do you want Russ to come back? Oh, neither does Charlie. You see, darling, nobody needs Russ.
Yes.
Russ is bad for business. And Charlie is first and foremost a businessman.
Who's that?
You know who it is.
Open up in there!
It's Russ.
Yes, darling, we know it's Russ. Now I'm going to open the door.
No, no, please.
Just stand back here against the wall. And when he comes in, shoot him.
Dottie!
Don't think about it. Just shoot him. I'm coming. I'm coming! Oh, it's Russ.
Yes, it's Russ. And I'm coming in.
Russ, darling, I...
Never mind that. I'll take care of you later.
Russ!
Hello, Frank, old buddy.
Russ, I'm warning you.
What are you pointing that gun at me for? You think you're going to shoot me?
Frank, what are you waiting for?
Huh? What do you think he's waiting for? He doesn't have the guts.
Show him, Frank, show him.
You double-crossed me, Frank. You and Dottie.
I made a mistake, Russ. I chose you instead of him.
So why didn't you tell me? Instead of sneaking around.
Would you have listened? You're right, Dottie. There's only one way. We have to kill him.
No, don't.
But you were the one who said
I don't know anymore.
Lower the gun, Frank.
Careful. It just might go off.
Charlie! Look, you keep out of this.
I just thought I'd come by in case the party got rough.
Charlie, what am I going to do?
Hey, wait. The three of you. Now, what do all of you want, huh? Russ, are you in love with your wife?
I thought I was. All of a sudden, I realized... I don't know. I'm in love with somebody else.
Then you can't object to Dottie and Frank being together anymore, can you?
No. No, when you put it like that, I guess I can't.
Well, then, what's the beef? Do you want to come back here to live?
We could find a job for you, Russ.
A job? What do I need a job for? To make money?
Well, yes.
But I got no use for money. I already have everything of value that it can buy.
Russ, I...
Look. You see? These pieces of paper. What are they? Magic talismans that bring food, clothing. Indeed, these pieces of paper can buy anything.
What's your point, Russ?
My point? I'm leaving. Why not? I was born in this very sleepy town. All my life I tried to bring an industry here, and I did. Now, the town doesn't need me anymore. Doesn't have any use for me. I should have realized that earlier.
Oh, Russ, please, something crazy got into us. For a minute, we lost our heads.
But we wouldn't have done it. I mean, you know we wouldn't have done it.
Yeah, I know. Goodbye.
Russ.
No, you don't want me to stay, do you, Dottie? Frank? Charlie? Well, then. Goodbye.
Were we all dreaming?
No. No. Russ was here.
My lord?
Yes, Malaya.
Is my lord truly happy?
Honey, your lord doesn't have a care in the world.
Ah, does that mean my lord will never go away again?
Go away? Why would your lord even think of leaving a place like this?
But my lord did leave for a little while.
Who left? Who went away? It was just your imagination. You dreamed I went away. And so did I. It was a bad dream.
My lord will never dream that dream again.
Malaya, dearest, this is the Garden of Eden. And there isn't a snake in sight. Come here.
Ah, well, paradise is what you make it. And also, paradise depends on your being able to keep it. The record doesn't show what happened to Russell Thomas Anderson, but I think he's still there. I mean, why not? I shall return shortly. That lush, lovely, luxuriant tropical island filled with beautiful, alluring, pliant ladies whose only mission is to please. I'm afraid that there are some of you who might look upon this as an exercise in flagrant male chauvinist piggery. Well, we can only deal with those dreams that have become a part of our literature. I'm sure that, in time, the distaff side will have publicized fantasies of its own, at which time we shall be delighted to record them for posterity on our adventures. Our cast included Tony Roberts, Joyce Gordon, Bob Caliban, and Russell Horton. The entire production was under the direction of Hyman Brown. And now, a preview of our next tale.
Well, it sounded as though someone cried out.
No! No! Please!
Shh! Shh, darling. No one will harm you. It's coming from the attic. It's her. The woman in the mirror. Oh, the poor thing. We've got to help her. We will help her, won't we? My big, big man. We shouldn't have locked her away, Christopher. We shouldn't. She's trying to tell us something. I can't. I can't turn away. She's asking for help.
This is E.G. Marshall inviting you to return to our Mystery Theater for another adventure in the macabre. Until next time, pleasant dreams.